Hello, another beautiful day back here in the Baltimore area. Surprisingly enough, the weather actually in the Reisterstown, Baltimore area is almost nicer than it was down in Tennessee, down in the Smoky Mountains. As I say, when we were down there, it was like really, really, really humid. It got pretty hot. And now here in the Baltimore area, it's like right around 80 degrees and the humidity isn't too bad. It's kind of funny. Because normally when I think about the Baltimore area, I think about like really, really, really bad humidity and heat. But this year it's not so bad. This year it's not so bad. Still feeling good. It's nice to be in cotton clothes again. Nice to have jeans on and a normal shirt and all that. It's one thing you go out and do the adventuring stuff and you get all like the synthetic clothing. Because the synthetic clothing dries a lot quicker and it doesn't smell as much, it's easier to wash and all that kind of stuff. But it doesn't have the feel of cotton, you know, that marketing gimmick where they say nothing feels like cotton. I do have to say, nothing does feel like cotton. So it is nice to be able to put on real jeans again and a real t-shirt. Be able to sit here on our little dock thing. Oh, sigh, I went off. I was happy to be back in town. And I had cleansed my palate of the disaster that was X-Men Apocalypse. Was it X-Men Apocalypse? And so I decided to go see Independence Day today. Is it Independence Day Resurgence or Independence Day whatever? So I did go to see that today. I was pretty excited. I was like, yeah, that'll be nice. Go sit in a nice big theater, watch a movie. That's almost impossible to screw up. And I have to say for anybody that's going to go out there and they're going to see the new Independence Day, make sure that you see the second movie first. Because that's the thing. If you see the first movie and then you see the new movie without seeing the second movie, the new movie is just not going to make a damn bit of sense. And then you say, but Eli, I don't understand. Isn't this the second movie? It's like, well, yeah, that's kind of the problem. So without all the spoilers and everything, basically what I can say is when you watch the new Independence Day, it is the first movie that I've watched where it really feels like you missed an entire movie. Like, there is so much backstory. There are so many references to, like, events and all that kind of stuff that apparently happened in these people's past. That's like huge, huge backstory for whatever the hell's going on. But they don't actually do anything with it. It's like the weirdest thing in the world. Like, it's hard to explain. But like, there's this whole battle that happened somewhere that they don't really explain a lot of. There's this whole type of alien spaceship that was doing things on Earth that you haven't really seen before. There's like all the most random stuff in the world that apparently should really tie into the main movie plot line, but they don't really bother to flesh it out at all. Like, there's this whole thing between like the young kids. So obviously, since the first one is 96 and it's 20 years later, you know, the people that were young before are old now, and so they're bringing in a younger group. And so that's the thing, is like that younger group has this entire backstory that sounds freaking amazing. It sounds like, wow, it sounds like they could have done an entire movie on the backstory of these young kids, these youngins. But that backstory just doesn't exist. It's just kind of like they jump in as if you know all of these things have happened. Like, there's just this one scene where the one guy slugs the other guy. And I guess you're supposed to have a feeling about this. But you're not really even sure why. You just know that the one guy pissed off the other guy, maybe could have killed some people. You don't really know what's going on. It is a bizarre movie. It is like, yeah, you just watch that movie, and like the feeling I had coming out of that movie is that I missed a movie. They just sit there and you're like, something happened. Like, maybe they did it in comic books? Maybe they did it in novels? I don't know. But there seems to be a massive gap in the middle. It just doesn't have the je ne sais quoi of the first one. I really have to say, a lot of people have been giving Independence Day crap. Like, with the new one coming out, they talk about how crappy the original Independence Day was. But I have to say, I mean, I think Independence Day was like a classic film, a classic sci-fi film. Independence Day is one of the few movies that if it's on TNT or something when I go to a hotel, I will still watch it all the way through. I have probably seen Independence Day like 30 times, and you know what? In my life, I could probably see it another 30. Because, you know what I'm saying? It's a pretty simple plot line. Everything makes sense. You care about the characters. It's funny. Yes, there's special effects, but it all ties within a storyline that you understand and you can get on board with. The new one does like what Star Trek did, where what's his name? J.J. Abrams. I hate J.J. Abrams as a director anymore. He's just screwing everything up. But where J.J. Abrams talked about that with the second Star Trek movie, where he threw things in to make the fans happy. And the problem is, like I say, with Star Trek movies, is although they may be campy as hell, they're very sincere in their campiness. Again, their world, their universe may be campy, but it's a serious camp. And so when you just throw things in to try to placate the viewers or the fans, it turns out into a mess. And that's kind of like what they did here. They took parts of the original movie that were really touching in a way, that there was really something to, and they recreated those parts, but like with zero feeling, with zero caring. Again, you see a main character go boom. It's like, I don't care. It's kind of like when I saw Han Solo get stabbed in Star Wars. Like, the most classic character ever. And J.J. Abrams just, you know, stabs him and chucks him off a bridge. And it's over. Like, one of the characters of cinematic history. And just gets disposed of like yesterday's garbage. And again, that's what happens in this movie, is one of the characters. One of the big characters. And he just gets kind of like thrown away. It's kind of like, oh yeah, well, we have to throw a bone out to the old fans. So we're going to replicate something that happened in the original movie, but we're going to do it in such a piss poor, unemotional fashion that when he gets blown to smithereens, you just really don't care. It's like, oh, he died. But anyways, and then it lines up. It so lines up for another movie. But again, who cares? Who cares? I think that's the problem I'm having with these movies anymore. I love sci-fi, but there has to be like an emotional connection to the characters. There has to be like some like where you actually care. It's like my wife and I, we've been watching like these cheesy shows. So we just I don't know if binge watch is the correct thing, but basically what we do is we just find one show that we like, and we just watch it all the way through, all the seasons. So I've been talking about, personally, she doesn't watch it, like I watch Supernatural. And again, Supernatural has no plot. No plot. Like, you just watch Supernatural. I'm like in the 8th season or whatever, and you're just like, I don't even get this. I like, what? It's just like, what am I watching? But the thing is, though, you actually care about the character. Like, Sam and Dean, I actually care about. Every time they get dragged off to hell, I'm sad that they get dragged off to hell, although I know somehow they'll come back from it. One time somebody goes off to hell, the next time somebody goes into a devil box, the next time he goes off to purgatory. You know, no, although it doesn't make a damn bit of sense, although this actually happened to any human being, they would have lost their mind at this point. You know, you keep going along with the story. If nothing else, for Cass and Crowley. They I truly have to tell you, so far as Supernatural goes, they have to do a show. They have to do a spin-off show, Cass and Crowley. I would watch that in a heartbeat. But again, no plot line there. But I love the show, because you actually care about the characters. Like there, when this one character, Bobby, died, and then came back as a ghost. I didn't quite get that. Like, it was actually like, holy shit, I can't believe they killed Bobby. Like, they actually killed Bobby. Whereas, like I say, these new movies, they wipe out, like, a significant character. You're like, eh. Is it over yet? Is it over? I didn't walk out of this one. I do have to say, I did not walk out of this one. But I think I'm gonna just start watching more movies on iTunes, to be honest with you. Especially, because like with this one, I went, and it's XD 3D. So it cost me $13 for a ticket for a not very good movie. So it's like, you know, on iTunes, I can rent the same movie for like $4 or $5. I've got a 50-inch screen, 4K 50-inch screen. You know what I'm saying? Like you got an XD screen, but it's like 40 feet away, versus a 50-inch screen that's like 10 feet away. Is it really gonna be any worse? So I'm starting to think I may just start skipping the movie theater. Again, I don't know what that is. Is this really like an age thing? Because I noticed that, like with older people, start complaining more and more and more about movies. So I really don't know. I don't know. Is this one of those symptoms of almost being 40 when you can't stand the movies anymore? Or is it just that the movies really are bad? It is really funny. It's just like you just sit there. You're just like, I don't care. Can you just kill them all yet? You know, if you just killed them all right now, you could just end the movie and we could all go home. But yeah. And then, like, they killed another character. And I think you're supposed to care. But it's like, I don't. Yeah, it's the weirdest thing. So anyways, that's what I did today. I went there, watched the movie, and have to say, wait for it to come out on VCD. Or wait for it to come out in torrent. I don't know, pay somebody a couple bucks. They did take the time and energy to make the movie. But it's really just so, like, I say, you see characters, oh, there's other characters that die too. Like, big characters that just die. And you're just like, I don't get it. They're like, I can't believe I saw that person die. You're like, yeah, whatever. I don't care. Yeah, you kill off the original cast. Don't care. Oh no, look! And again, that's the thing. In the first movie, you have people die. You're like, no! That's when you're like, oh, yeah, whatever. So anyways. So I have decided to try to be more communicative with you folks. I'm actually going to start trying to respond to some of your folks' comments. So you folks leave a lot of comments during a given day. And so what I'm doing is I'm copying the comments, and then I'm posting it in an email, and then sending my email to myself so that I can then look at it on my little iPad screen here. So I figure this is a way we can have a little bit of the communication, have a little bit of the discussion. Discussion is back and forth. Again, as I talk about the whole concept of how we conceive time and how we conceive communication, I suppose this is a new way we can do communication. One to many, many to one to many, or whatever. But it is something to think about. I know I blather on about this whole thing about like a new world of communication, but I do feel like not enough people really think about this. Like really think about the fundamental way that we are starting to communicate really is different than anything that any generation has ever known before us. And one of the issues that I see is that not enough people are experimenting with it. Because there are new ways to do things, there's new ways to communicate, and we're not communicating well, we're not communicating efficiently. Again, and this is where you go like the whole Brexit thing before, and the whole like the liberal and the progressive policy. Again, for the most part, I'm on the side of progressivism. If I'm not on the side of the, I'm not on the bandwagon of progressivism. But what I see is the biggest issue is that progressives have stopped talking to people that aren't progressives. And they've stopped explaining what they're trying to do. Again, like I say, when I talk about globalization, when I talk about free trade, when I talk about the free movement of people, I try to explain this as a person who is able to travel around the world, who is able to travel within the country, and trying to explain it as the more open we can be, the easier it will be for people. Again, right? You know, if even like I say, even with immigrants, and we worry about illegal immigration and all that kind of stuff. But here's an ironic thought. Would we have as much problems with immigration, like here in the U.S., if people could freely go back to their country? If they could come here relatively easily, make their little bucket of money, and then go home, who knows, right? Maybe half the Mexicans would leave if they knew they could come back again. There's this whole theory with how you deal with people, that people are much more worried about loss than they are about gain, right? So if you have people in the United States and they're here illegally, they are worried about, life may actually not be going well here for them, but they're worried about losing the ability to stay in the United States. Like, I knew somebody from Guatemala who came here illegally and then went back to Guatemala because, frankly, he said his life in Guatemala was better. And I looked around and he was like, well, I make a lot more money here, but it also costs a lot more money here, and I don't have things like health care and all that kind of stuff. So really, on the whole, picking tomatoes in Guatemala is a hell of a lot better than building roofs in the United States. But the thing is, if people are willing to go back and forth. But I think that's the problem. That's the whole thing with communication is the progressives have stopped communicating. They simply state at this point, globalization is good, and if you don't believe in globalization, you're a xenophobe. And then they wonder why Trump won the GOP and all this kind of stuff. It's like you gotta be talk, discuss. And so again, with doing this, not only am I talking about technology and geeks and all those people trying to be able to discuss things, but also, like I say, everybody else. How do you discuss things in the modern world? How do you have communication so everybody feels that they're on board? And that's the types of things that I'm trying to experiment with here, and that's why I'm trying to use this as a little bit of an experiment. So in the comments, I understand Eli the computer guy isn't of interest anymore, but wouldn't it be smart to subcontract out content creators to keep it alive? Have some trusted people do the work, keep the golden goose alive, cough, NCIX, tech tips, cough. So I've got three channels. I've got Eli the computer guy, and that's the one that made me famous, world famous. And before you laugh about that, I actually got stopped on the street on the way to the movie today. Aren't you Eli the computer guy? So again, I'm not sure what it takes to convince people that you're famous, but at this point. So that's the one. So it's 712,000 subscribers now. Eli Computer Guy Live is a question and answer one with, I don't know, 75,000 subscribers now. And this one with 7,000 subscribers and growing. Actually, 7,100 to 7,200, right? So basically, I'm stopping doing Eli the Computer Guy basically because, or I'm de-emphasizing it massively, mainly because it's run its course. It's run its course. Again, that's one thing you have to think about in business, your professional career, or if you're going to be creating content, is sometimes you basically get to the end of the storyline. And that's how I feel with Eli the Computer Guy, is, what I'm really good at, and what I'm a professional at, is frontline support for small and mid-sized businesses. And again, 10 years ago, there was buku bucks in it, there's a hell of a lot of value, it was great. If you want email services for your small company, you have to build an Exchange server, a lot of money. Oh, you need a backup system, a lot of money. Oh, you need to tune up your computers, a lot of money. Oh, your hard drive failed, a lot of money. Right, there's all this stuff. Now, you fast forward to now, and basically the only reason people are still having as many computer problems as they are is because they're stupid and they don't want to pay for good equipment, right? You know, if you pay for Gmail, if you pay for Google Apps for $5 or whatever per month, you get an email service that basically works perfectly. You get your apps, you get all that kind of stuff. You can do Office 365. Basically, there are just so many solutions out there, and the issue is the new stuff, the new cutting-edge stuff for IT is no longer what gets deployed in the office. It's the stuff that's farther out there, you know, Puppet, Chef, Docker, Linux containers, that kind of stuff. And you just start going out to a degree that most people just, unless you're higher up, unless you're really building out big infrastructure, you're just never going to need this stuff. The reality is Google Drive works. Again, as I talk about it, I believe it's the death of the IT professional and the rise of the technically proficient professional. A lot of people disagree with me on that. That's an argument you can have over beer or whatever. So basically with Eli the Computer Guy, the big thing there is my story has essentially run its course, but I don't want to do a Chris Perillo on my channel and basically start doing these videos over there. The reason is because since it has 712,000 subscribers, that's a beautiful thing. And it's still gaining like 10 to 15,000 subscribers per month. So by reasonably, it'll probably hit 1 million. So here's the thing to realize, is when you build something beautiful like that, sometimes the best thing you can do is put it on the shelf and show it off. versus do much more with it, right? Because if I started doing these videos over there, there's a good chance that I'll lose subscribers, right? So what I can do is I can put that on a shelf, and then I can tell sponsors or whatever, that's the channel I made before. So imagine if I can do that with tech, what I can do with lifestyle, right? So that's there. I will start keep doing some videos for them, for it actually. I'm going to do some more of the theoretical stuff, you know, what is the practical use of augmented reality and that kind of thing, mainly because I have some sponsors that paid me money, so I have to deliver product. So I've still got to do at least 15 more videos over there, just to flush the sponsors out of the system. So yeah, but then the question then becomes, well, why don't I subcontract out the work, kind of like NCIX and Linux Tech Tips and all that kind of stuff. So the big channels, what they do, like with Linus and all that, is it's all very scripted. You have editors and all that kind of stuff. Basically, you plop anybody you want in front of a teleprompter, and they say the stuff. The issue is with all of my channels, it's all been about a discussion. It's all been about a conversation. I'm about as anti-Linux tech tips or NCIX or whatever as you can be, right? It's not 5 and 10 minute videos that are very short to the point talking about the newest specifications of graphics cards. It's these long, blah. So again, the problem is if I hire people or I subcontract people to do a different type of content, are people going to stick around? And the issue is people that can that understand technology to the point that they can do long form content like I do are few and far between, right? I mean, there's Lewis, there is he who shall not be named. But other than that, I mean, how many people can you just blather into a camera about a technology topic for a reasonable amount of time? And so those are some of the kind of issues that you run into. If I change the type of content over there, I risk losing subscribers. And then if I do get finding people to do it, that's a real pain in the ass. And then I've got to manage the people. You've got all this other stuff going on. And for me, like I say, it's just not worth it. It's not worth the time or money. Again, as I talked about that with Eli, the computer guy, coming over here to do Fail Normal, is there was money on the table. Again, that's what I try to talk to you folks about, is like the real world. And there was money on the table. I mean, these were checks that were being written. This was money being offered. And I had to look at my life, and I was like, well, what's another $100,000 going to do for me? I understand the amount of work I have to do for an extra $100,000. I don't understand how my life gets better for another $100,000. And that's a year and a half ago, kind of how we got into this whole transition. So again, the issue becomes with keeping Eli the computer guy alive. I understand how I make money. I understand how I can theoretically make money doing it. I understand theoretically how I could set it up to do it. I understand the stress and all that kind of stuff involved. I don't understand where my value is for keeping it alive, though. Again, I know Fail Normal right now looks like a bit of a joke. 7,100 subscribers. Making me, what are we up to? We got a couple of new Patreons. It's kind of surprised with all my crap about Brexit, but I got a couple of new Patreons, even with my crap about Brexit. So, you know, we're up to, I don't know, $310, $311 bucks per month off of Fail Normal right now. But the thing is, now that I'm a YouTube professional, I've been doing this for 6.5 years. I see a lot of value in what I'm doing here. I see an incredible amount of value that I'm doing here. I mean, like literally, I mean, right now it seems like a joke. But I can argue why I believe within 3 years this will be worth hundreds of thousands of dollars a year. So again, what you have to look at is if you honestly believe, and again, I'm not blowing smoke up your ass. If you look how people connect to my videos, right? Again, right now, average view time is like 16 minutes on these videos, right? So if you look at how people connect to my videos, if you look at the type of viewer, my demographic of the type of viewers that watch this, if you look at all those things and then you extrapolate out 2 years from now, and like I say, I've already gotten sponsors and all that kind of stuff in the past, you just see how this can be worth a lot of money. And also the thing is too, is what I like about this channel for money versus Eli the Computer Guy is, remember, when I was with Eli, when I was doing Eli the Computer Guy videos, and I would have sponsors and I have people come to me about money, I have to be very careful. I have to be very careful because, you know, if I tell you to buy a certain type of server or a certain type of software, and you put it into your infrastructure and it fails, I am a technology professional. That directly reflects back on me. Right? That's a bad thing. On the other hand, if it would fail normal, I mean, not to sound too lackadaisical here, but if I wear an Under Armour t-shirt or I wear a North Face raincoat or I drive a particular vehicle, who cares? You know what I'm saying? You know, I'm not going to tell you I like it if I don't, but I'm not so worried about being precise there. It's like, hey, you know, North Face or Under Armour or Patagonia or whatever gave me this nice new raincoat, and it feels pretty good, and it's pretty lightweight. You know, if I don't give you a 100% perfect review, I'm not too worried about it. You go to REI, you put the coat on. If you like it, you like it. If you don't, you don't. It's a fucking coat. Again, it's not like putting stuff into your infrastructure. So again, that's one of the issues I've had with Eli the Computer Guy, is the sponsors come to me, but I've had to say no to a lot of money just because I don't, like I say, if you saw my review of IX systems, that's the biggest problem I have, is they send me this product. I can't tell you why the hell you should buy the thing. It doesn't make a damn bit of sense to me. Like, it literally doesn't make a damn bit of sense to me. Whereas, like I say, if you send me a raincoat, I'm like, look, it's a raincoat. I mean, the raincoat's not gonna, you know what I'm saying? But anyways, so that's the very long, stupid, that's a very, very foolishly long reason. Eli the Computer Guy will go its own little way. It'll take some time, but whatever. There will be some more videos there. I'll probably tape them next week, I guess. Hello, Eli. I'm a German citizen and longtime follower on all of your channels. I say it short. Your perspective and thoughts about the Europeans point the nail on the head. For us is a bad time. Hopefully we stabilize it in one way or the other. So this is just a point. For all like the little snarky people out there, again, I tell you folks my opinions. I tell you folks my perspectives. And you are completely free to agree or disagree. I don't care either way. As long as we get a good average view time, that's all I care about. Again, I don't care if you thumb up or you thumb down, as long as you do something with your thumbs, right? But one of the things, I've gotten a lot of crap over Brexit. I've gotten a lot of crap over some of my opinions about the European community, and a lot of people saying, we all know you are stupid, blase, 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 blase. And the one thing that, the one reason I said this quote from a German citizen saying that I have the nail on the head is just to realize not everybody agrees with the people that are disagreeing with me, right? One of the reasons why I say some of the things that I do, even if they seem a little harsh sometimes, is because sometimes the things that I'm thinking, a whole bunch of other people are actually thinking, they are just not so uncouth to say it. So again, before you go all snarky ass batshit on me about one of my opinions, just give it a second and realize I may not be the only one thinking that thing. Again, a lot of people think I try to be controversial, and I really don't. I just say it like it is. If it happens to be controversial, hey, it gets me a better average view time, so that's a good thing, right? So it's one of those things just to be keeping out there. And this is a good one, too. Tell me you one thing. Whites are pretty disgusting. Your ancestors are disgusting savages. Just to prove to you folks that, yes, white people aren't the only bigots in the world. I would like this to be pointed out with a lot of people that get like all crappy about like white people. Do remember, like when you say crap about white people and all white people in general or all males in general, this is not reverse racism. This is not reverse sexism. This is racism. This is sexism. This is one of the reasons why white males are getting a wee bit pissed off in the world, is because everybody says racism is sexism is bad unless you're bashing white males. And then it's a-okay, right? So the one thing that I'll have you think about is this really a good mentality? Again, I mean, I talk about how a lot of the cappuccino folks in the world get beat over the head sometimes. But again, you be humans too. Again, I've been to India, I've been to Thailand, been to Sri Lanka, been to Nepal, been to Cambodia. You people aren't like some fucking like little utopian great people either. You're people. And again, I'm not saying that Europeans and even Americans haven't beat you on the head and that you don't deserve to be angry at other people. But that doesn't mean you're wonderful people either. It's interesting, like you go to India, And especially like when you're dealing with people that serve you, the services class. Believe me, the white people are absolutely appalled with how the higher level Indians treat the lower level Indians. Like, you see how some of the higher level Indians treat the lower level Indians, and you can't believe that. Like, you will just be absolutely dumbfounded. So again, when we start talking about like prejudice and all that thing, just be careful. Again, it's feel free to hate America. Feel free to hate white males. But like, just like, feel free to hate me. Feel free to hate me. But be careful when you start saying like those people are savages. Like, for me to say Africans are savages is ridiculous and stupid. On the other hand, for Indians to say, or whatever, Sri Lankans to say, or whatever, Americans are savages is kind of equally stupid. Again, I brought up that whole European thing before, and we'll talk about it there, just because I don't know what it is. Like, so many Europeans, there's just like this arrogance card that they play. So many. And all I was saying before with the arrogance card is no more. After Brexit, I just won't accept it. Let's see here. My personal view for it, it's good enough. I voted to leave. It's best for us. So there are young people that actually want to leave, young people that are happy with the Brexit thing. That's kind of an interesting thing that I saw with the whole echo chamber thing of Brexit. Is over there in Britain, it seems like people are in the echo chamber. Like, I got a lot of comments from people saying, like, I don't know anybody who voted to leave. And then I got a lot of comments like, fuck Europe, I want to leave. So yeah, just one of those things. Think about it with your echo chamber and all that kind of stuff. Let's see. I totally disagree with Eli when it comes to opinions and discussions. Not everyone needs to take part in the discussion, and some opinions should not be shared because they are less than worthless. You are correct. Your opinion is less than worthless. Shut the hell up, you stupid little person. Right, you don't like that. You don't like that. If I told you to shut the hell up because your opinion was less than worthless, that the person that wrote this, that was just a travesty of words, you wouldn't be happy about it. And then you would go and you would tell people that Eli is a complete and utter idiot. So the one thing that I would have to say is just be careful, because I was talking about that before, the freedom to speak. So yesterday I did the video on freedom to speak. And that if you allow people to speak, that most of the time they will talk themselves out of bad ideas, right? If you allow them to speak, they will talk themselves out of bad ideas. So when you keep people in the rational world, when you keep people in the logical world, they will what's called self-correct. They will find the best path. The problem is when people drop the rational world, and they start focusing on emotions and anger and that kind of stuff, that's when crap goes bat crap cray cray really damn quick. And so I was talking before about if you let people speak, if you let people talk, it's a way for them to work things out in their mind. And I talked about that before where I was the straight guy in the basement for a lesbian couple. I went out to the gay bars. I hung out with gay guys. I had an employee that was gay. We were called the Elis when I had my shop because all the gay people loved us. Again, across the board, supported the gay community. And then I found it really funny and sad in a lot of ways, because I went to a bar one night with a friend and we were drinking beers. And I was trying to discuss it and process it and talk about all these things, because gay marriage was in the news and all that was happening. And so I was talking to my friend and we were like going back and forth about ideas. And then the lesbian that apparently was sitting beside me really could not tolerate the things that I was saying, and so it started telling me to shut the hell up, and I had no place to talk about gay people. And I found it really strange and odd, and it was the first time that I felt anger towards gay people, because I was being told to shut the hell up. It was like, I'm the straight guy in the basement of a lesbian couple. I go to with them to the gay club. You know, I'm there getting flirted with by the gay guys and telling them no. You know, I have gay clients. I have gay employees. I am trying to work through the concept of how all of this works out. I'm being told to shut up. And that's the thing. All the way up until I was told to shut the hell up, I was fine with what was going on. And then you start to worry, like, wait a minute, wait a minute. So we're not even allowed to talk about this. right? That's when you're like, right? So again, that's where I say everybody should have the discussion, but you don't have to be part of the discussion. Again, everybody should have the right to speak. That doesn't require that you listen to them. Again, discussion is back and forth. And so as I say, if you think I'm a complete and utter idiot, hey, that's A-okay. Turn off the damn video. Right. You know, I think white supremacists should have the ability to speak and say what's on their mind. It doesn't mean I have to sit down and listen to what they say, but they should be able to speak, you know. Black Lives Matter should be able to speak. Police officers should be able to speak. All of these different people should be able to speak. And I think if you're able to speak, then it calms things down. But so many people feel like they are not able to say their side of the story. Then anger and aggression and all that build up, and then things go all like little bat crap crazy. Why do you repeat yourself? Why do you repeat yourself? Just want to know. Just want to know. Again, a lot of people give me this crap about why do I repeat myself? Again, because these videos are supposed to be an hour long, at least. A lot of times they go for an hour and a half or 2 hours. But basically, when you're doing like a talk show and you're talking a lot, you do have to remember what is the product that you are providing to the end user, right? So if you're the Vlog Brothers, your product is a 3-minute video. That's what they do. Vlog Brothers create a 3 or 4 minute video, and that's what they do. That is their product. So therefore, they don't repeat themselves, because you can't repeat yourself in like 4 minutes. Me, on the other hand, this is like a talk show that you have on in the background, so I repeat myself, because I'm taking up time, to be honest with you. I got an hour to fill. And then the other thing is, because I know it's a talk show, I know how I listen to talk shows, and like when I listen to National Public Radio or I listen to other things, my mind isn't 100% on the show itself. So a lot of times I miss chunks. Like I just tune out like 5 minutes worth. So I have found when people repeat themselves, one, when I'm listening to it, I don't mind because I just have it on the background anyway, just like music or whatever else. And two, if I get lost in the conversation, or I get lost with what they're saying, if they repeat, then I can figure out what they're talking about again. I noticed this the other day. My wife and I were listening to this really long NPR thing on some kind of like synthetic drug. And it was long. It was like this whole 10-minute spiel. But we missed like the first 2 minutes of the 10-minute spiel. And they never reiterated what the hell this synthetic drug actually was. So we sat there for like 8 minutes listening to this radio show thing, not really comprehending what they're talking about, because like with radio and all that, there's no back button. And again, the way that I figure people consume this content is you press play and it plays, right? So that's why. How do you deactivate ad block for this single channel only? Does anyone know? I do not know how to unblock a channel, or deactivate ad block for a channel only, because with YouTube, the channel name isn't in the URL for the video, so I don't think you can do it. But might I suggest you simply disable ad block for YouTube. Do you remember how we pay the bills? If you like what YouTube creators do, throw us a bone. Watch a 15-second commercial. I'm telling you, because most of the time you can skip the commercial anyway. So, you know, it does take time and energy to create this content. So I'm just saying, like, for everybody, why don't you just turn off ad block on YouTube? It really does matter. It really, like, again, I'm not going to get into a bitch fest about it. I stopped arguing about that crap a long time ago. I'm just saying, like, everybody's got bills to pay. If you can pay your bills off of content creation, it means you can focus more on content creation and less on other stuff. You know what I'm saying? So, let's see here. You'd fit right in on poll for Reddit. Apparently I would. I don't know, though. See, I just can't get into Reddit. Like, a lot of people say you should get into Reddit more. So I know Grade A, Under A is all big on Reddit. And I know Lewis Rossman, he who shall not be named. He got big into Reddit. He did the whole AMA thing. I just can't get into Reddit. Like, when I go to Reddit, it's kind of like with Snapchat. Like, even now, like with, you know, Twitter and Facebook and LinkedIn and all that kind of stuff, at some point, I finally figured out how to use it, and it's fine. It's acceptable. Like, Reddit I know it's a huge thing, but I go to Reddit, and it's just like a headache to me. I don't really... It's just like you see this stream of consciousness in front of you. I'm not really sure what I'm supposed to do with it. Like I'm one of those people that honestly, I believe the way that we can make the internet better overnight is simply by getting rid of comments. Like if every single website simply threw out their comment section, I think that would make the internet a hell of a lot better, like overnight. And so Reddit basically seems to be a comment. It seems to be like a comment section without a website. And so I don't really get it, to be honest with you. I'm not saying that you shouldn't use it. I'm just saying me going there, you know, I've created an account in the past. And I'll go there like every couple of months. Be like, okay, now I'm going to get into this. And then like a day later, I forgot my password again. So anyways, let's see here. Eli, I've watched over 100 hours of your content, but I am unsubscribing because of your last video. It was borderline racist and completely out of touch. You can't lump 700 million people together in the way you did there. By the way, I'm Irish, not European. The United States is not a continent. It is one country, just a large one, started by Europeans. Good day! I can't even word how annoying your last video was. It pretty much cancels out all of your other videos. I can't even articulate this right now. I'm too annoyed. Two things I remember paraphrasing. Show me you can build a modern anything before you can talk. What the actual fuck? You have these tiny countries and they can't even decide on one language to use across Europe. The second one is one of the most stupid things I've ever heard, as if they all planned it this way. So again, this is another person complaining about my views on Europe and Brexit and all that kind of stuff. I don't know what to say. The funny thing that I find with people like this is you watch 100 hours of my videos. So 100 hours of my videos is about 100 hours of my videos. If you've actually watched 100 hours of it, that's 4 solid days. Right? So you've watched a lot of my videos. So here's the thing that I want to tell people with this whole thing, I'm unsubscribing or whatever, is remember, when I create these videos, when I talk to you folks, there is supposed to be a value here, right? There's supposed to be a value. I do not beg you to subscribe. I do not beg you for Patreon money, though I will accept your Patreon money if you want to give it to me. I don't beg you for any of these things. I am not grateful for you to be here. The reason is because this should be a two-way street. I should be providing you information and insight that makes your world better, makes you think about things in different ways so that you can interact with the people that are important in your life differently and be more successful. And for that, you watch a fucking 15-second ad and I get whatever I get for CPM, right? It's a two-way street. So what I want anybody to think about, whether it's me or anybody else, if you have honestly done something like watch 100 hours of somebody's videos, and then one video pisses you off so much that you just can't stand it anymore, just kind of think about that. Just kind of think about that, and think about what you're losing. Again, this person thinks I'm losing a subscriber. Oh, no. Oh, no. Not a subscriber. Right? So to me, on the whole, again, I get paid CPM per 1,000 views. One subscriber doesn't really matter. It just doesn't. Doesn't. I know I'm supposed to say it is. I know I'm supposed to say, I love you all. Each and every one of you is a valuable, unique snowflake that I would hate to lose. And if you want to watch people like that, go watch Boogie. Boogie2989 or whatever the hell. He loves to tell his subscribers how much he loves them. I don't love you. I don't care about you. If you get hit by a bus, you get hit by a bus. You are a viewer of this show. I appreciate that you watch the ad and that you turn off Adblock and maybe you throw in a couple of bucks to Patreon. I hope you appreciate that I give you content that is valuable for your life, right? And so what I want you to think about there is what damage are you doing to your life because you can't handle people that piss you off? Again, that's one of the things in my business relationships and so many of my relationships. I don't necessarily like all these people. I don't necessarily respect all these people. But I don't have to respect or like somebody for them to be far my superior in tax law. I don't have to like or respect somebody for them to be far my superior in networking or web design or anything like that. I mean, I think that's one of the things as a technology professional, if you get all fucking bent out of shape about people who piss you off, you're going to be the help desk the rest of your damn life. Right? You know, I remember that. Like, one of the stories I had, really, I was working for this company, and we were doing this big migration, and I was very low on the totem pole, and it was hard, because I had been high on the totem pole for my last company, and now I'm low on the totem pole. But at this company, they were big on pissing contests, they were big on ha-ha-ha, and, you know, giving shit to the people that are low on the totem pole. And so a couple of the people would, like, lose their minds. A couple of people that are lower on the totem pole would lose their minds because they're like, look, I'm highly trained, I'm highly educated, this is bullshit. And they get pissed off. And it was funny because one of the managers came over to me one day and she was like, you know, it's so funny, it's so weird. You let all of our shit just roll off your back. You never get pissed off or anything with whatever we say to you. And they just looked at it. It's like, I'm not worried about it. She's like, why is that? Because I'll be your boss one day. And it was funny. It was funny. A lot of this shit ended after that. Because I do have to say, this is like one of those little power play things just to think about, is when you take everybody's crap and you smile and you let it all, you roll off your back, and then there's just that one time when the people approach you and say something like that, and then you just look them square in the eye and say, oh, I'm not worried about it. Oh, why is that? Because I'm going to be your boss. There's just that finality, especially like I say in the tech world, where like fortunes can change rather quickly. I mean, you can go from being a peon to being Mark Zuckerberg, like literally in like 4 years, right? It's just like, right? But that's the thing, is to realize people are going to piss you off and people are going to irritate. I am, right? If you watch my videos on any consistent basis, I hope to hell I piss you off. I hope I piss you off, right? I equate the teachers' unions to Al-Qaeda, which I agree with. You know, I call Obama, you know, our most ineffectual emperor president. I call, you know, Trump and Hillary, one of them scrapple and one of them's bratwurst, right? You know, I poke everybody. I talk about how fat America, you know, I was talking about big-bellied Americans and all that kind of stuff, right? And I poke people because I want you to think about things. I want you to think about what you're doing. And it may come off as offensive, like when I was down at Pigeon Forge and you saw all those fucking fat-ass people. And now, you know, first thing, if you're a fat-ass, you might be, well, Eli, that's offensive to us fat people. But again, as I say, I'm not actually saying it to be offensive. What I'm trying to say is when I look at these fat people, I can't imagine how much energy it would take to have another 75 pounds on my body. When you see these fat people that are basically my age, and they have to take a shuttle from the parking lot to basically where the mall is because it's too far to walk, and my wife and I are just strolling over there, you know, it's like, oh, that's so offensive. Dude, it's not fat shaming. It's... do you maybe want to change some things in your life? Right? So again, like I say, with the Irish people and all that kind of stuff. And again, like I say, as far as Brexit goes and all that, because I was talking about that before and I was getting all pissy. And my wife was like, yeah, you seem to take that personally. And yeah, you're damn right to take Brexit personally. I'm fucking pissed at Brexit. I say with these videos, I may be melodramatic, but I don't try to exaggerate. I don't lie. Try not to lie. I don't try to exaggerate, because I believe exaggeration is a lie. I may be melodramatic sometimes. But have no doubt, I am fucking pissed to high hell and back about Brexit. Brexit is the biggest level of bullshit I can imagine. And again, like I say, as an American, here's the thing, right? Here's what I want you to understand about Brexit and this whole European dog vomit mess over there, is as an American, I am saying to the world, we need somebody who pushes back on us. We need somebody who is strong enough to get us to stop. Because the thing is, Americans keep going. We are like a fucking freight train, one way or the other. And we need, again, as I talked about in the one video, we need a counterbalance. We desperately need it. A lot of Americans that I know, when we talk about it, we really don't like the fact that we're a superpower. We really wish, in a lot of ways, that we were like Canada and could just be like, dum-da-dum-da-dum-da-dum, right? But the fact is, we're not. And so we need a big counterbalance. And again, I would prefer that counterbalance be Europe, because Europe, again, they got some quirks. I'm not saying we see eye to eye, but we see relatively close. Again, I would prefer Europe be the counterbalance versus China, which it probably will be, or India, because we really don't. I mean, again, take an American and drop them in India, or take an Indian American and drop them in China, and there's just a lot of shit. We just, you know, it's not like we see eye to eye. Like, they're looking that way. And again, I'm not saying that they're wrong. I'm not saying that the Chinese are wrong. I'm not saying the Indians are wrong. I'm not saying that we are right. We just look at things completely differently. And that's when you can start having some real harsh problems. Again, even with the Russians, even back when you had the USSR, the reality is the US and the USSR, again, we did see things differently. There was definitely a difference there. But there was a lot more similarities than anybody would want to admit on either side. Whereas, like I say, the Asian countries, there's a lot of difference. There's just a lot of fundamental difference. And so that's why I'm pissed with Europe, because Europe is just spinning around in the same absurd shit it's been doing for the past 500 years. And we all had hoped you had grown up. You know what I'm saying? It's like, and again, like I say, this whole thing about like one country with three languages. Just pick one. Just fucking pick one. I don't care what it is. Pick Swahili. I'm just, you know. But anyways, so again, if you get pissed off with one, oh well. Basically, we are all going to hell in a handbasket. And I just have to say. Ham basket sounds pretty good. Somebody said that he misspelled that. It's supposed to be hand basket. But I'm telling you, as an American, if you want to make a lot of money, figure out how to make ham baskets. If you make ham baskets, I'm telling you, that's got to be a $1 million idea right there. You could have like the deep fried ham basket and the roasted ham basket. Take ham, like you could have like, you take ham and you weave, like, you weave ham into a basket, and then you could have, like, the bacon-covered fried ham... The bacon-covered fried ham basket. I'm telling you, you come to the United States with a bacon-covered fried ham basket, you would be a millionaire so damn quick. We're a country where we were actually proud. It was on the news when somebody figured out how to fry butter. Well, truly, there's this guy down in Texas, and all he does is he experiments with how to fry things, and he goes to all the Texas fairs, and he figured out how to fry pats of butter, and he sold fried butter, deep fat fried butter, and he made a killing. He sold out of his deep fat fried butter. So I'm just saying, again, if you want to leave that European place where they all have this thing called cuisine, you come here. To where we have deep fat fried butter. I'm telling you, ham baskets, deep fat fried ham basket wrapped in bacon. If that is not a $1 million idea, I just don't know what is. I think that'll be that for today. It does take a little while to go through all these questions. So, I'll keep that in mind. Maybe that's how we can extend these little videos out for a little while longer. Maybe we can take it to an hour and a half or something. Because now that I have that encoder, like right now, this is encoded at like 1080p, 60 frames per second, because I can upload it here, because I got 35 megabit per second connection. But now when I'm on the road, I can decrease it in size quite a bit. So now that I know how to decrease it in size, and I can upload from the road, I don't know, maybe we can extend these out to an hour and a half video, especially like if I answer your questions or whatever. That might be an idea. That might be an idea. Because I like blathering into a camera. I don't know what it is. Again, I'm not like this in the real world. If you ever meet me in the real world, I just sit there and I'm kind of quiet. I'm just quiet and I listen to people. I don't know, he put me in front of a camera, and I just brain vomit. But anyways, the main subject I wanted to talk about today is this whole, I miss Keemstar, man. I miss my Keem. So who is Keemstar? Keemstar is like the biggest punching bag on YouTube right of this second. I'm not saying it's necessarily wrong for that. So Keemstar right now is most well known for Drama Alert. There's this YouTube channel called Drama Alert that talks about all the news and drama going on in the YouTube world, right? So talks about things going on with PewDiePie, talks about things like lawsuits, talks about pedophile accusations and all of that kind of stuff. Up until like a week ago, it was an incredibly fast growing channel. So I started watching it back in like February or something like that, and it's grown by like 500,000 subscribers since then. So like when I started watching, it was about 1 million subscribers. It got up to 1.6 something million subscribers before Keem left it for a week, and now it's been sinking ever since. But I found it to be a very good channel, and I've talked about this before. A lot of people say that that Drama Alert is the cancer of YouTube. A lot of prominent YouTubers say that. PewDiePie, I think, says it. Grade A Underage just did a whole video very explicitly saying. A lot of people say that that Drama Alert is the cancer of YouTube, and I really just don't agree with it. And again, I'm not trying to be contradictory here, and I'm not trying to be sensationalist or whatever. I have just found over the past 4 or 5 months that Drama Alert is actually a channel that I find to be very valuable as a content creator. One of the biggest problems as a content creator, especially if you're not cool, you're not like grade A or whatever, is you're not part of the cool kids club. So one of the interesting things is whenever you see these large YouTubers, they always talk about the YouTube community, right? Boogie talks about the YouTube community, Vlogbrothers talk about the YouTube community, grade A talks about all these people he talks to. You know, all of these people talk about the YouTube community as if this is one big community that we're all part of and all can communicate with. And what I say, as I've said before, is basically when you look at YouTube, YouTube is just like an insane version of high school in a lot of ways. It's like high school on crack. So like, in order, like, you become popular because you are popular. Right? Like, the more popular you are, the more popular you become. Again, that's one of the reasons why I want to keep my subscriber numbers very high on Eli the Computer Guy, is having if you go to a YouTube channel and they've got 700,000 subscribers, it's more likely that you will subscribe to the YouTube channel. But the thing is, with that too, is you get the preps, essentially, the varsity folks in YouTube, kind of like the varsity folks in high school, and then they start talking about all this high-minded shit, right? They talk about, oh, how all the people in the, how it's a really good high school, and all the teachers are really good, and everybody gets along, and everybody cares about world peace and all that crap. They keep saying that right up until they go and they beat the shit out of some poor geek in the bathroom, right? And they never see the irony there. Right? It really is true. It's like you go to high school and you have all these high-minded people, the high-minded, you know, varsity and all that kind of folks, and then they'll go just fucking wreck the hell out of the lower peons, and then they don't think twice about it. They think it's all good, and that's the issue that I see with the YouTube community, is you have the varsity, you have the preps, and they see YouTube as one world, and they interact within YouTube as in one world. And then there's the rest of it. Again, even with 700,000 subscribers, I'm not a cool kid. Again, the only big YouTuber I communicate with at all is Grade A. And that's the only reason I think that happened is, one, that motherfucker took off quick. I remember when he only had 1.2 million subscribers back in like January or whatever. So one, he took off quick, and two, he was doing a video and all the ways that YouTube was screwing up, and I had happened to give YouTube the middle finger right at that time, and so we ended up talking. But honestly, that's it. Like, the Vlogbrothers wouldn't return. I highly doubt the Vlogbrothers would return my email if I emailed it to them. I don't think anybody else really cares about me. And I don't say that from a snarky, mean way. I just say that as such. Like I say, there's this idea of the YouTube community, and then there's what there actually is. Again, I email with Lewis Rossman a decent amount. Probably a couple of times a week. I, you know, communicate back and forth with Barnacles every once in a while. You know, there are some YouTubers I communicate with, but again, like I say, there's this whole idea that, like, it's this vibrant community coming together. Again, for some people it is. For some people it is. For most of us it's not. And so the issue is YouTube doesn't give us a lot of support. YouTube has started to give us some support now. It's doing a hell of a lot better than it was. And I'm quietly optimistic. Again, distrust, verify, stay suspicious. I am in the stay suspicious mode. I'm in the stay suspicious mode. Because I'm always in the stay suspicious mode. But I do have to say YouTube is getting a lot better. One of the reasons why I'm a little more confident about talking with people about being professional creators is, again, I've been with YouTube itself since 2009. So, again, I'm not a Vlogbrother era, but, you know, it's 7 years at this point. And I read these, like, they really are changing how they deal with creators. They really are. Again, I'm not saying they're fucking perfect. But on the other hand, if you stay with kind of my rule about staying a mile away from the rules, I think you're pretty solid here. And what I mean by that is, like, with the copyright issues, again, if you're going to do reaction videos, there's still a huge question on what is technically fair use and all that kind of stuff. So you could do something that's theoretically right, and then you could still run into problems, blah, blah, blah. And so, again, as I say, if you create content like I do, you know what I'm saying? Don't use anybody else's intellectual property. Don't advise people to go hurt other people. Again, stay the hell away. Like YouTube has their rules, and I say stay a mile away from them. Again, from an adventuring standpoint, as I say, my wife and I, we went to the Grand Canyon. One of the things we were surprised about is the trail that goes beside the Grand Canyon is literally beside the Grand Canyon. And if you go off the trail, you are going to drop 1,000 feet. And there's no handrails. There's no fence. It's trail, dirt, die, right? And so the way I think about the rules in the YouTube world is, if I was walking around in the Grand Canyon area at night with only the moon to see by, I would want to stay a fucking mile away from the edge of the canyon. Because I might be doing fine. I might be really fine walking on the trail for 3 miles until I see an owl and go, oh, look at that. Right? So I stay away. Right? And so YouTube's better. But the thing is, though, but there's not a lot of support. Like I say, just like basic stuff, you know, what people are doing right, what people are doing wrong, best case scenarios, worst case scenarios, white papers, that kind of stuff, right? You can figure it out. But that's why I like Drama Alert, is because it actually is useful that way. You know, when somebody is getting sued, they talk about somebody getting sued. When there's some little pissing contest between YouTubers, it talks about the pissing contest between YouTubers. When somebody gets doxxed, they talk about somebody getting doxxed. And again, you may think it's all just for their advertising or whatever, but it does bring up an interesting point. You know, if Grade A Under A gets doxxed and Pyrotechnical gets doxxed, that's its own thing, but Pyrotechnical gets doxxed and all these other people get doxxed, you know, that's bad and that's horrible. And again, I don't get into morals and ethics with all this stuff. What I say is, what is the practical? So if you're a professional content creator, and you're seeing that other creators are getting doxxed, so this is where your personal information is given out, then you need to start thinking, do I need to personally worry about getting doxxed? And then how do I deal with that? Not how do I bitch, whine, moan, and complain that it's happening, but if this is a real issue, how do I deal with that? If people are getting swatted, my danger for getting swatted, all these kind of things. And so that's why I watched Drama Alert, and it was good, like I say, under Keemstar. I find Keemstar to be somebody that you can listen to. As I talked about before, I think he is a level 9 douche. And that's the thing, is with drama or any of this kind of stuff, you just have to realize that you're going to piss off people. People are not going to be happy about the things that you say. And you've got to do it anyway. And you got to pull off doing it, right? You know, if you're too nice and kind and happy or whatever, you know, you just can't do drama. Again, one of the things I tell folks out there, a lot of people want to jump on the bandwagons. You know, when they thought that doing reaction videos made money, they all want to start doing reaction videos. And now that they see drama videos is making money, now they want to do drama videos. And one of the things I'll warn everybody is I have nothing against drama videos, but make sure you have the attitude that it can accept the consequences for drama videos. Like Boogie talked about that before, where he said he was doing videos based on drama. So Boogie, the Francis guy, the big old fat gaming guy, not offense, he's fucking big. And at one point he said, I had to apologize to all of his people for doing these drama videos. And I had actually watched some of his videos where he had talked about some of the things going on in the YouTube community. And to be honest with you, I did not think they were drama. I did not think they were offensive in the least. I did not think they were drama. I thought he was talking about stuff going on in the community. Again, good, bad, whatever, not too bad. But then he had to apologize profusely because his morals couldn't accept that he was part of the drama cycle. I would argue he was putting too much on himself, but he was, and so he stopped. And so that's one of the things with people that want to do drama channels, is you do have to realize that you may gain a lot of anger. People may be very pissed at you and may not like you, and may say stuff a hell of a lot worse than even the Irish are saying about me right now, right? If you can handle that, if you can deal with that, hey, fine, go with it. If you can't, then don't do a drama channel. The thing with Keemstar is he can handle it most of the time. All the hate comes in, and he keeps on eating his popcorn. It's funny to watch, right? You know, somebody gets hate, and he's eating popcorn. Yeah, all right. So I've been watching Keemstar. I've been watching Drama Alert and all that. And again, overall, I liked it. I liked Drama Alert. I liked it with Keemstar. It's all pretty good. Well, the issue is whenever you're dealing with YouTube, the thing is with any of the personalities on YouTube is they have their channel and they have their brand on that channel that they present, and then they're real human beings in real life. And with a lot of the YouTubers, one of the things you have to realize is a lot of the YouTubers, they try to find the way that they're going to be successful. And in that process, they can piss a lot of people off. Right? So the one nice thing with me, and one of the reasons why, again, the worst most people can call me is a fart bubble, is because I never really wanted to be famous. Again, I never planned on doing YouTube as a profession. This is one of those stupid spaghetti monster things. I just, you know what I'm saying? Like, this was not the fucking plan. I'm not sure I'm not sure what the plan was at this point. This was not the plan. So the nice part for me is when I started doing YouTube videos, and all the while that I've been doing YouTube videos, I've never tried to be vulgarly offensive. And I've been pretty specific not to be vulgarly offensive. And what I mean by that, now some Europeans might be like, fuck, you called us dog's vomit. Yeah, but you're Europeans. But no. But the thing is, like a lot of people out there, when they try to be edgy or whatever, they go into the whole N-word thing. They go into the whole kill somebody thing. There's this whole thing like with the millennials, like where I feel like they've lost their mind when it comes to communication on the internet. Like I say, like this whole like nasty, 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 vicious trolling. And the biggest problem with the nasty, vicious trolling is it actually gets a lot of views, and a lot of people like to see it, and a lot of people like to pile on. And so one of the issues you get with a lot of YouTube content creators is that they want to be YouTube content creators. That is what they want to be. This is how they will be successful. I saw YouTube and realized I wanted to be on YouTube. But they didn't really know how they were going to be on YouTube. They didn't know what they were going to be providing on YouTube. So they got onto YouTube, and then they started playing and figuring things out. And the problem is with some of these folks is the way they played and figured things out was to be nasty and vicious and horrible. And the weird thing that I find in the world, is some people, when they're nasty and vicious and horrible, are like, Leafy is here, and they get like all the success in the world. People love them. And then other people who are nasty and vicious and horrible, people don't like. Again, it's kind of like smelling, you know, whoever smells your ass. Like, if I was truly vulgar, if I started saying the N-word, and I started saying all this horrible, I don't think anybody would really tolerate. Again, like, ironically enough, when I call the, you know, Europe the equivalent of political dog vomit, people know I really don't have any anger when I'm saying this. Again, I'm pissed as an American because we're losing our counterbalance, and I'm sad for them because I don't really see how this is going to end out well. But it's not, right, there's not that, whereas, like I say, when people get, like, really vicious, you know, things can be taken weird. And so you have these people that have been built up, and so they've done different channels, and this, that, and the other thing. They've tried a lot of things, and some things have worked out well, and some things are kind of nasty and horrible. And so that's one of the issues with Keemstar, is that a lot of the stuff that he's done in the past just doesn't come off well when you do a soundbite of it. Right, when you do a soundbite of it, it just sounds horrible. There's just no way to say it otherwise. It just sounds horrible. And again, since it's now the internet, it all sticks around forever. I mean, one of the nice things about being a Gen Xer versus being a millennial is we could be worthless bastards, and it's lost to history. Again, you know, I mean, that's one of the ironic things, even though I'm a YouTuber. One of the reasons why I'm not that worried about being doxxed, completely honestly, is I don't think any of you motherfuckers could be able to make sense of my life. And I don't mean that from, like, a snarky or even an arrogant standpoint. It's just true. Like, my life hasn't been lived online. It really, really, really hasn't been lived online. By the time I got into Twitter, by the time I got into Facebook, I was already married, I already had a house, I already had dogs, I already had my small business, right? So, if you went and you tried to dox me, I mean, you may find my naked pictures, and then you'll realize that they're hanging in art galleries. True story. My naked pictures are published in real magazines, not Playboy. I see a lot of gay people right now. Oh, there's naked pictures of Eli. Yes, my naked picture has been passed as a present to a prominent person. That's true. Oh yes, you know you're a cool geek when your naked picture is presented as a present. But anyways, so like I say, even if you go and you do find my naked pictures. No, I'll stay there. But the issue is, like I say, with the millennials, is so much of the crap that they've done is actually online. It's there. It's there for people to see. It's there for people to comment about. It's there for people to draw connections to. Again, like I say, like, I've known a lot of different types of people in my life. I've known political leaders. I've known gang leaders. I've known military and police. I've known terrorists, right? I've known militia folk, really fucking nutty militia folks. And the nice part, though, for me, the good part, being of the Generation X, is all those relationships just disappear as time goes by, right? You know, you settle down, you have a house, you have a couple of dogs, you have a wife, and anybody that may be of disrepute, anything that may be of disrepute, just disappears into history. The hard part with these folks, though, in the modern world, and the millennials, is they've grown up with social media. And so much communication and so much of that socializing happens in a public forum. So the issue is now people can go back and they can look at what you did 7 years ago. They can look at what you did 8 or 9 or 10 years ago. And they can start making comments about you now based on those things. So if you look at Keemstar, I guess he's 34. So they talk about some of the video footage from when he was, from 7 years ago. So when he was 27. I did some interesting things when I was 27. It was not the same stuff I was doing when I was 34, right? The nice part for me, though, is again, Facebook. I don't think Facebook existed when I was 27. didn't exist when I was 27. So whatever I did, it disappears, right? Dancing naked on the beaches of Sri Lanka? No, that didn't happen. Was that me? I don't think it was me, right? And so the issue is with Keemstar. So basically, he's doing Drama Alert. That's pushing a lot of people's buttons. Creating this thing that is exploding very quickly. Doing the whole news drama thing. Trying to figure out where lines are, where boundaries are. He pushes boundaries now that he probably shouldn't push. Plus, he has all this backload of stuff that people can show that he's a cancer or whatever to the YouTube world. And so basically about, I guess it was a couple of weeks ago now, probably 2 weeks ago, a lot of people went batshit crazy on him and essentially are trying to get him off of YouTube entirely. So Pyrotechnical, never watched any of his videos. He apparently claimed that that Keemstar doxed him, so basically released his private information. Leafy Is Here went batshit on him. I watched Leafy Is Here thing, whatever. And then Grade A Under A did two videos completely and utterly bashing Keemstar. And it was really kind of interesting to see. And it's good. You can go over there and you watch it. And so a lot of people might be saying now, Eli, have you not seen the Grade A Under A videos? Have you not seen Why We Should Hate Keemstar? Have you not seen Leafy Is Here? Do you not see that Pyrotechnical was doxxed and therefore Keemstar is cancer? And the issue is, and can you not see all this stuff in the past? And the issue is, and this is one of the issues that I would tell you folks, is I don't look at people as a single thing. Again, I think we have nuance. I know we have nuance, because again, the personality that I present on videos is not the exact personality you meet in real life. And that's not the exact personality that my wife is, right? There's a lot of different levels whenever you're dealing with people. Again, I thought Bill Clinton was a good politician. If he went anywhere near my daughter, I'd break his fucking kneecaps. I can have both of those thoughts simultaneously. I like Bill Clinton as president. If he went near my daughter, I'd break his fucking nutsack. Right? Well, does that mean you like Bill Clinton or that you hate Bill Clinton? I'm saying, as a politician, I liked him. Better not fucking go near my daughter, right? And so basically what I look at with Keemstar and what I look at with Drama Alert is I have found Drama Alert to be very useful. I have found Keemstar to be a very good host for Drama Alert, and therefore I would like to see him back on Drama Alert. Does that mean he's a good person? Not at all. Not at all. I'm not saying I want him over for a cocktail. I'm actually not saying I don't want him over for a cocktail party. I don't know him. I don't know him well enough. Like I say, I see all the bashing and stuff out there. But again, maybe it's because I'm Generation X that I remember how much stuff is just lost to people's memories, you know, is not documented. So you see a lot of this stuff and you don't really know like how bad it is. But what I can say is I can enjoy Drama Alert. I can enjoy Keemstar on Drama Alert and have that separate from how I would see him as a normal person. And I can see it separate from what he did 7 years ago or 6 years ago or even last year. Again, I think that's one of the big problems that people have when they're dealing with YouTube creators is that, again, you know, I don't like the trolling. I don't like how some of the drama and all that kind of stuff goes. But I can understand that people that are trying to be good people can make mistakes. And can do things that they don't necessarily fully approve of and wouldn't continue in the future. Again, what somebody did last year isn't necessarily what they're going to do this year. When I look at Drama Alert, since I've been watching it, I don't see much that I'm offended by. I think there's too much content on Clara Baby Legs. I still don't understand why she gets so much video time. But other than that, I mean, sometimes it gets a little boring, but otherwise it's not really that over the top since I've been watching it. And so I look at this block of time, Drama Alert with Keemstar, and it's like, you know what? Since I've been watching it, it's not that over the top. It's not that horrible. right? And so this is just something to be thinking about. Like whenever you're looking at people, is so many people, there's this idea of perfection anymore. There's this idea of perfection. That if people are not perfect, if they don't live up to every single frickin' ideal that you can pull out of their out of your ass, that you have to lambast them. Again, the Irish guy, watches 100 hours of my videos. And again, all of my videos are trying to get you to think. All of my videos are trying to get you to think about how to make your life better. And yet, after one of my videos, he's like, I'm unsubscribing, I'm done with you, because I found that to be racist. Europe's not a race. But anyways, right? And so that's the thing, is like, so many people, they want other people to be perfect, and it's not going to happen. And so that's where I look with Keemstar. Is he a great person? Is he a great father? I have no fucking clue, and I don't really care. On Drama Alert, he's good. And then that's the thing, though. Well, but Eli, you don't need Keemstar to have Drama Alert. Well, to be honest with you, because grade A, under A, he was talking about Scarce or Source or whatever that is. He said, go see Scarce. And again, I like grade A. I think grade A is a good person. So he said, go over and see Scarce. Scarce is better than Keemstar. Hey, fair enough. So I went over to see Scarce or Source or whatever the hell it is. The S thing. I don't like Scarce. I don't like his presentation style. He's one of these people that has like the video game going on in the video and then talks over it. I really dislike that style. It's not a good style for me. It doesn't fit. I don't like Scarce. I went and I saw Ty Blue. So Ty Blue took over Drama Alert for the past week. And I got to see Ty Blue doing it. And let me tell you, Ty Blue is not a level 9 douche. I don't think he's a level 3 douche. I think he's a level 10 marshmallow. If you ever watch Ty Blue, he seems like a good guy. He's a very good presentation. A very good presentation on videos. Speaks very well. But I mean, he's like a marshmallow. He's like a down pillow or something, trying to like talk about drama. Again, like there's something like Keemstar. Keemstar does look a bit evil. There's just like a little viciousness in Keemstar. So when he says news or drama, you're like, yeah. Right? When Ty Blue's doing it, you're like, oh, it's okay. Would you like some more milk? Go to bed? Here's some more milk, Ty Blue. You go to bed and I'll be up in a minute to read you a bedtime story. And again, I think he could do other content. But he doesn't do drama very well. So I've looked at these drama ones. So I've looked at Ty Blue doing Drama Alert. And it is Drama Alert. And a lot of the ways that Drama Alert is being done under him are basically the same in a lot of things. But he's just a marshmallow. He's a good guy, but he's a marshmallow. I look at Scarce. And again, I just don't like how Scarce does it. Again, not that it's bad or anything like that. I just don't prefer that style. I had been subscribed a little while to Philip DeFranco. But I actually found Philip DeFranco to be a complete fucking ass. There was a couple of things that Philip DeFranco did that were just like really incredibly vicious, like truly vicious, like on his show. Like not something he did. I don't follow these people on Twitter or anything else. Like on the show, it was like rather astoundingly bad. So I followed Philip DeFranco for a little while. But I actually think he is... Like I say, it was to the point, like, I'm staying away from this. And so basically, I come back to the end of the day, like, okay, well, if you're doing drama, the best presenter and the best show that I can find is Drama Alert. So I would like Keemstar back on Drama Alert. And that is my thought on it. That is my thought. And now some people might be going like, well, Eli, what about the doxing? So that's a big thing with Pyrotechnical. Pyrotechnical got doxed. So some of the arguments with Keemstar. Pyrotechnical got doxed. I don't know what to say with these YouTubers getting doxed and complaining about it. And I'm sure all my shit's going to be online pretty soon for saying this. But we are on YouTube. We are making ourselves public. I don't know how to deal with it, think about the whole doxing thing. Because I remember like when Grade A was talking about that, about getting doxed. And I think about it from like the security standpoint. They've talked about that in the post 9/11 world and the military and all that overclassification. This whole idea that basically too many documents, too much information is being classified when it doesn't need to be. In the military world, that adds a whole bunch of expense. And it means a lot of communication isn't happening, because whenever you classify something, not only does the person have to have the same classification level to be able to read it, but they also have to have a need to know. So if a piece of information is top secret, even if I have top secret clearance, there also has to be a need to know for that. So the problem is you get this issue where people aren't communicating, people aren't talking. Like in the tech world, in the startup world, it's all about communication. The more people can talk and communicate, the better. Because people get ideas, people toss things around, so on and so forth, which you would think is good in the intelligence world. You would think would be good in the military world. And so the problem is, if things get overclassified, that means all of this information can't be talked about. So if you're following one person, right, and you think that they might get radicalized by ISIS, and I'm following, you know, I don't know, that person's brother, and that person's brother goes off to fight in Syria. You know, if we can communicate, I can say, hey, yeah, you know, this guy I'm following, you know, blah, 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 went off to fight in Syria. You're like, fuck, what was that last name? Blah, 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 blah. Crap, I was just looking, I think that's his brother, and we were worried about him getting radicalized, right? You can get this communication, but it gets overclassified. And so one of the issues that I think with the whole doxing thing is that people get really worried about their personal information, you know, phone numbers, addresses, all of that kind of stuff. And in the real world, what I would argue is this information that needs to stay so classified? Is this information that needs to stay so personal, or is trying to keep it classified and secret, all that kind of stuff, in effect, just something that you can't do, and something that you're going to be frustrated with if you try? Again, I've had my fans and my followers and all that kind of stuff basically send me emails with my address on it. Yep. Because here's the deal. One, I've got a lot of insurance. Always buy good insurance. And two, if you try to do anything, well, if I'm not here and you try to do anything, then there's security cameras that'll catch you so I can give you the information to the police. Again, if you try to do anything with me, I would warn you. I would warn you. Just saying, it might not work out so well for you. And so I think that's one of the things with the doxing is there should be a thought with more of these content creators is you are becoming a public persona. You are becoming a public personality, and with that come security concerns. Again, like I say for myself, you know, that's one of the things, like with the bodyguard stuff is people that wind up having to get bodyguards and protection that never even really thought about it before. And when you think about it, you mean, you think about people like Grade A, or you think about people like, you know, Pyrotechnical or whatever. We got 2.5 million subscribers. I mean, there is a question about, do you need to move into a condo with a reception desk? And again, this isn't about being a YouTube content creator. This is about being famous. But think about that, like with Grade A, right? Is it so funny with YouTube? Everybody like poo-poos YouTube. Again, that's one of the reasons I talk about being famous and being met on the street and all this kind of crap, is trying to get it through people's heads that this is real. And even content creators really don't get it. Like when you've got 2.5 million subscribers, when each of your videos is getting 3 million views, right? You are up there with a real star. Again, not me. I'm like YouTube famous, right? I'm YouTube famous. But like Grade A is famous. He is, I mean, 3 million views on something like YouTube is really, you know, per video is really fucking impressive. That means you are famous. And so again, we can beat up Keemstar all you want, and by all means, beat up Keemstar. But is Keemstar the canary in the coal mine? Right? If you get theoretically doxxed by Keemstar, if Keemstar actually doxxes you or anybody else doxxes you, Is it really that Keemstar is being really horrible, or is it that you've actually reached a level where you need to do things like concern yourself about security? Right, this is something to really think about. You know, if you are a serious YouTube content creator, you should know how to be bludgeon the hell out of somebody if you need to. Right? Again, me coming from the non-creator world. Right? And so it's things like that. You know, with a lot of the stuff with like Keemstar and all that, like with the doxing or whatever. I mean, doxing is part of our profession. If you can't handle doxing, this is not the profession for you. Because the thing that I always look at, like with things like Keemstar, is Keemstar able to dox you because his wife works for the FBI and therefore was able to get information other people weren't able to get? Because he was able to spend $5,000 to have a private investigator follow you and get information other people weren't able to get, right? So if Keemstar is able to do that, then fine. He's a complete and utter nasty bastard, and you should sue him or whatever, go after him legally if you can. On the other hand, if he can simply Google search all this information and pop it up, I would argue it's more of a warning sign to you that you really need to think about what is your security policy. What is your security policy? Do you have a security policy, right? If you had a stalker, what would you do about it? And actually think about those kind of things. So that would be my thought there, the things like doxing and that kind of stuff. And then it comes to the whole pedo allegations, pedophile allegations. Keemstar kind of stepped in the dog shit with a couple of those. On the other hand, like, he stepped in the dog crap with the old guy. He blamed about being a pedophile. Some of the other stuff, though, again, if you're going to be in the YouTube world and you're going to be creating content, if you are an adult and you are creating content towards a younger audience, again, it kind of goes back to that whole security thing that I would argue is I think you should have something a little more solid than Keemstar as being an asshole, right? Because pedophilia, and all of that is a really big, is an honest concern in the real world. And again, one of the issues that we have is that YouTube content creators are not seen for who we are. We are not seen for how influential and how powerful we can be. You know, when I went to VidCon, was it 3 years ago? There were a lot of screaming 13-year-old girls running around. Holy crap! There was a lot of screaming 13-year-old girls running around. I had no idea until that point. I had no idea that 50% of YouTube viewers were screaming 13-year-old girls. But there are a lot of screaming 13-year-old girls around. And so, again, with the pedophilia accusations, especially when other people make the accusations and then it's reported on by Drama Alert, I think your best bet with that, and again, it's something to think about with yourself, is how solid are you? Again, if somebody claims pedophilia accusations, how easily can you laugh it off? Right? If somebody accused me of pedophilia, Keemstar could go on fucking Drama Alert tomorrow and accuse me of pedophilia. Would it fucking matter? Right? Because I don't communicate with 13-year-old girls. I barely communicate with my fan base at all. You're not going to find any record of my communication with anybody that's going to seem off. Right? At all. And so I think with, like, again, like with some of the YouTubers, is I don't really think they think about the position that they're putting themselves into and thinking about how they would deal with it. Because again, right now you focus on Keemstar and, like, well, he accused me of pedophilia, blah, blah, blah. But again, how many people in the U.S. get wrongly accused of pedophilia, and then how many of them go to prison? Truly. And so if you are a YouTube star and you are going to be meeting your fans or interacting with your fans in anything more than replying to their comments, you really have to think, does everything seem completely 100% legit above board? Like, if you handed all of your communications to your wife, would she get bored reading them? You know what I'm saying? Like, I could hand every single email. Because, again, when we're traveling, my wife always uses my computer for some reason, so I know all my shit's legit, right? You know, she goes into my own damn comment stream. Like, anyway, dear, it's my fucking communication. I swear there's nothing for you to look at. But that's the thing. Like, can you hand all of your communications to your spouse and have your spouse be bored looking at it? Or if your spouse saw it, would they be concerned about what you're saying? And I think that's the big thing that a lot of people aren't thinking about. Again, like I say, because, you know, with my nonprofit work and all the kind of stuff I had to do in the past, again, the whole thing with sexual abuse was huge, right? Especially back in the 90s and trying to get a handle on it. And so, like, I don't want to meet, again, that's one of the reasons why I don't want to meet anybody under the 18 years old. Right? Again, everybody, they're fucking 40, most of them are like 40s, right? But again, I don't want to meet young viewers. Thankfully, I don't have a lot of young viewers, simply because I don't want to run into any kind of weird-ass issues, right? Because as soon as you start meeting kids and interacting with kids in that way, then it brings up question marks. And then if you're not 100% legit with everything you say, then it can start getting really weird. Right? And so you got to think about that. Are you communicating with people in a way that if you handed it to your wife, it's good? Again, if you're going to meet with people, like generally when I meet with people, it's out in complete open or in the public. So like if you meet with me for a Silicon Trailer, now I do it at the RV park, but we sit down at the fucking picnic table within eyeshot of 50 different travel trailers. Right? You don't go into my travel trailer. Maybe if it's raining. Again, it's not a huge rule because I'm dealing with 45-year-olds. But again, we sit down, and so there's no, oh, he touched me. What, at the fucking picnic table with 50 people looking? Right? You know, I don't invite people to my house. I don't get into those situations. If we meet somewhere else, you meet at a Starbucks or meet someplace publicly. And so again, yeah, he touched me in the wrong place. What, in the middle of a Starbucks? Right? And so again, these are some of those things to be thinking about. Because I think a lot of the YouTubers, again, it's really easy to blame Keemstar. And by all means, blame Keemstar. Blame Keemstar. He's a level 9 douche. He can take it. But I think a lot of the things that he brings out, and I think a lot of the reason that people are scared, is they realize that this is fundamental weakness. And what I would argue is you have a fundamental weakness, you figure out how to secure from that fundamental weakness. Because things are only going to get bigger. Again, like I say, with grade A, under A, with doxing and all that kind of stuff, I've talked with him a little bit about some of this kind of thing, but it's like, if he's not thinking about what he's going to do when he has 5 million subscribers, he's a fucking idiot, right? You know, when he talks about people, when he talks about vegan gains, saying shit about vegan gains, God bless, right? But you know, Vegan Gains may have some nutty-ass follower that's even nuttier than Vegan Gains and decides to carry through with one of Vegan Gains' threats. And so that's the thing. Like, if you're going to be famous, then how do you deal with that? What is your security protocol? What is your security policy? And if you don't have that, you really got to think about what you're doing. Again, you can blame Keemstar all you want. But Keemstar version 2 is going to come down the pike, or Keemstar version 3, or Keemstar version 4. Keemstar did a video trying to defend himself. And again, I don't know if it's a good video or a manipulative piece of crap. It was a 50-minute video. But one of the things he talked about was that some of the things that he's getting blamed for, Philip DeFranco did like 10 times worse. And that's the thing to think about with this, right? Is if it's not actually illegal, then if Keemstar doesn't do it, then you have to think Keemstar version 2 might do it, or Keemstar version 3 may do it, Keemstar version 4 may do it. Somebody coming down the pike will. So again, you can get Keemstar kicked off, but that doesn't really solve your problem. And so I think that's the bigger issue, is I would argue with a lot of these YouTube content creators, you need to be thinking about this stuff. What is your policy for meeting fans? What is your security policy? If you got a stalker, what would you do next? I think if you think about all those things beforehand, life will get a lot easier. That's my thought. Again, I don't know. Would I want Keemstar in my house? I have no idea. Do I want Keemstar hosting Drama Alert? Damn right. Again, a lot of people are pissed off or whatever. Oh, well, people be pissed off. The Irish guy's pissed off. You know what I'm saying? So, that's my thought. And again, like, with some of these people, too, like, there is a bit of, like, hypocrisy, like with Keemstar. Because it is kind of funny. Like I say, and I love Grade A's content. I'm subscribed to Grade A. I watch every video Grade A does. But again, Grade A does a lot of drama shit. He's built up a lot of popularity off of drama shit. And not everything he says or does is right. Perfect, right? You know, something, like I say, Leafy is here. Holy shit. Even Leafy is here, like, admits he's, like, the biggest troll on the internet. Right? So, again, like, there's this weird... And that's one of the things you have to be careful about in life. And I talk about this a lot. Is the whole bandwagon mentality. Where people become the targets of hate. Simply because... the bandwagon has decided they should be targets of hate. And you got to be careful with going along with that. You got to be careful about going along with that. Because a lot of times, it's not that person is right or wrong or should be defended. It's the issue is you don't know when that hate will end. Right? That would be my thought there. Because again, like I say, is if you go after... Keemstar, then you can go after Leafy, right? Then you can go after Grade A, you go after Philip DeFranco, you go after this person, you go to that person, all that kind of stuff. I don't know. I think by and large, though, I think overall, I think a lot of the drama has kind of jumped the shark. I think with this whole Keemstar thing, I am definitely not interested in the drama anymore. I will be curious with Drama Alert when he comes back. How much of it is news and how much of it is drama. I do have to say with all this is I feel like drama is played, at least drama for me is played out. Again, like I say, the news stuff, who's getting sued, why they're getting sued, who's theoretically a pedophile and all that kind of thing. That I'm still interested in. But like just the drama, like I say, Clara Baby Legs. Yeah, nothing against Clara Baby Legs. But... I think he's a bit fixated on her for some reason. That is my opinion. It seems that Keemstar may be a little fixated on Clara Baby Legs. So yeah. But that's the other thing too, like I say, with all this stuff, when you watch this, is again, always think about the takeaways. Always think about what you can learn from anything. So again, like I say, like when you see people accused of pedophilia or going after minors, right? There is the issue about whether that is a right accusation or a wrong accusation, all that kind of stuff. What I want my viewers to do is to think, can somebody put this accusation on me and have it have any legs at all, right? I want you to think, if you're a YouTube content creator, if somebody accused you of pedophilia, or if somebody accused you of trying to have sex with a 15-year-old viewer, would there be any legs to that argument? And again, what I say about that whole be a mile from the edge of the Grand Canyon, if there could possibly be any legs to that argument, then you need to change what you do so that there isn't. Again, like I say, for me, when I meet my... Yes, I meet my viewers in person, and I do it in exceedingly public places. And I do it with real fucking adults. And most of them are kind of geeky men. So, I mean, no offense to geeky men, but it's not like, and then he touched me in the weird place, in my naughty place. I know. No. All right. But anyway, but that's the thing. That's one of the ways that I can stay secure on the whole pedophilia argument. Is it right? And so again, that's the thing to be thinking about. Are you meeting with your viewers? If you are meeting with your viewers and they're 15 years old, think, is this really a wise thing? If you are going to be meeting with viewers that are 15 years old, you know, especially if they're the opposite sex, then make sure you're there with somebody the opposite sex, right? You know, make sure there's two adults there. Make sure there's three adults. Like that's, I dealt with the Civil Air Patrol for a while, and that was a thing, like, with female cadets. Anytime I interacted with a female cadet, there had to be two adults there. It had to be me and another adult. And they were all reputable, like, real adults. Most of those people had security clearances and the rest of it. And so that was a way to stay safe. So again, it's not he said, she said. It's he said, she said, she said. Right? Then again, you got to be thinking about this. And again, that's where I would argue drama alert is valuable, because it makes you think about that. If you get accused of pedophilia, do you have somebody to back you up? Do you have somebody reliable to back you up? Again, like I say, when I was meeting with cadets, you know, I'd have some director of NSA with me. Though you probably wouldn't trust that kind of person. But you know what I'm saying. Like, it's like, right? That person gets a fucking polygraph test every month. So, but you know, that's the kind of thing to be thinking about. So anyways, I've been babbling. I don't know what it is. It's like the fresh Baltimore air. I feel comfortable sitting here and talking. I do. So with that, I guess we'll call it a day. Again, I support Keemstar on drama alert. That bubble. I'm not saying he shouldn't be arrested for something else. I'm not saying he shouldn't be tried civilly for something else. I'm not saying I would invite him to a cocktail party. I am saying on drama alert, I support Keemstar. And again, that is one of those things for you folks to think about, because everybody wants to put sons of bitches on pedestals. Everybody wants to put people on pedestals, and holy crap, if they stray 1 inch off the line, you want to lambast them for being horrible. And again, I'll say, none of us are perfect. Nobody is perfect. If you're expecting a perfect person, I tell you what, if you want people to be perfect, you be perfect. The day that you are perfect, the day you are beyond reproach, then you can worry about everybody else being perfect. Until that point, just take them for what they are. Keemstar on drama alert. That bubble I miss. Everything else, that's what you gotta think about. I think the final thing. Oh, you knew it was coming. You didn't think I was actually going to end when I said I was going to end. The final thing, though, I think with the problem that Keemstar is getting into, and again, this is something that you do have to think about if you're going to be a YouTube content creator, is YouTube content creators are much more associated with their channel brand than other types of stars or celebrities, right? So Mel Gibson can go all like batshit anti-Semitic. And at the end of the day, I can watch Expendables 25 and still like seeing him show up. Right? Like, I don't associate Mel Gibson's anti-Semitic rants with the character Mel Gibson is playing on Expendables, right? They really, to me, are two different critters. Like, when I see Tom Cruise in the next Jack Reacher, whatever, movie, I don't think at all about Scientology. Like, at all. It's not that I have an opinion good or bad on Scientology. When I'm watching Jack Reacher, Riker, whatever it is, when I'm watching that and I'm seeing Tom Cruise there, that is truly a character. I see that character that happens to be played by Tom Cruise. So one of the things, and this is one of the things that Keemstar has tried to do, and I don't think he quite grasps the modern world's media, is that we in YouTube are much more closely associated with our characters on YouTube than other actors are. Again, like I see Felicia Day every once in a while on TV shows, right? So I've seen her on Eureka, and I've seen her, well, I just saw her on something. I just saw her on Supernatural. I saw her on Supernatural. But she's been on, right? So she has jumped from YouTube to TV. But I still have to say, like, Felicia Day is solidly that character on The Guild. Was it The Guild? On her YouTube show, The Guild. Like, every time I see... It's really weird. Like, when I see Tom Cruise, I just see the character he's playing and don't think about Tom Cruise. When I see Felicia Day, I always see the character that she played on The Guild. There is something different about how we connect with YouTube celebrities versus... normal celebrities that really, 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 like I say, it's a different type of thing. So it is also important, like with this whole Keemstar thing, one of the arguments that Keemstar makes is, you know, I was a character doing this on YouTube, or there is the Drama Alert brand and the Keemstar brand, and it's his right to make that argument, but I don't think that comes out in people's heads. Like, I associate Keemstar with Drama Alert. If he says some batshit cray-cray stuff on Twitter, if I followed his Twitter, I don't actually follow his Twitter, but if I followed his Twitter and he said batshit cray-cray stuff on Twitter, I do directly associate that with Drama Alert. Like, if Tom Cruise says batshit cray-cray stuff on his Twitter, I don't associate that with the next, you know, the day after, whatever the hell movie he does at all, right? Like watching Supernatural, if I followed one of the actors on there, I would not associate their Twitter with Supernatural, but I would associate Keemstar's Twitter with Drama Alert. And so again, that's one of those arguments that Keemstar is making that logically, I agree with him 100%. From a logical standpoint, you should be able to say your stuff on Twitter and be able to say your stuff on Twitch TV and say your stuff on other things under Keemstar and then come to Drama Alert as Drama Alert. But in the head, again, like I say, I'll just say that with Felicia Day. Like, Felicia Day will always be the character off The Guild. I don't give a shit what TV show she's on. She's always that character off The Guild to me. And that is different than when I look at normal TV actors. So I think that is also something to be very careful about, is if you are going to be a YouTube star, or try to be a YouTube star, is that you are associated with all of your social media accounts, all of that, much more closely than other people are. So, yeah, I would say that. But anyways, I don't know. Did you like the question and answer thing today? I think I'm going to start doing that a little more, try to do that a little more. We can go through. It'll be my little way of communicating with you folks. Because you guys just have great ideas. You just have, like, the most awesome ideas in the world. Hell in a ham basket. Hell, how am I telling you? That should be a restaurant. Like, in the South. I don't know. I don't know. Where would you do hell in a ham basket? Like, Texas or something. Oh, yeah, I was in the panhandle of Texas and went to this restaurant called Hell in a Ham Basket. They had a fried ham basket and bacon wrapped ham baskets and sugar fried ham baskets. Hell in a ham basket. I'm telling. See, every day I try to give you a $1 million idea. Every day I'm here to give you the $1 million idea for you to grind away at. Hell in a ham basket. I am telling you, if that is not, that is pure gold right there. That's gold with, like, platinum-rimmed, diamond-studded idea right there. Hell in a ham basket restaurant. I say, you do it down in, like, Texas or something? Like, somewhere in the South. You gotta be a Southern place. Hell in a ham basket. Oh. It's one of those, I wish I was a mutant, so I could, like, turn myself into, like, 6 different people. I would definitely do hell in a ham basket. My wife would hate me because she's vegan. Oh well, I could get a new wife. Anyways, let me stop before I go too far. But that is your idea for the day. Hell in a ham basket. And with that, we're almost at the 2-hour mark. So I'll call it a day. See you folks in the next video.